Our next speaker is Aurélien Roux, who is a professor at the University of Geneva. Thank you, Aurélien.
Thank you, Monica. Thank you, Fedra and Noël, for inviting me. I'll be very personal, and that's a tough talk to give because I usually don't speak about me in the presentation, but more about the work of people working with me, and I'll finish with that, I think. But since I'm a biologist, I thought that starting with me would be a good way to use genealogy, and so this is my family tree. It starts very simple, but as many of you have experienced, my parents divorced when I was a kid, and my father remarried and got a second marriage and two daughters from a second marriage. So you may think this is the end of the story, but it turns out that my mother did marry a second man, got a son from it, and then again divorced and married a third man, got a daughter out of it, but this man was also divorced and had three sons. I can tell you now that I'm trying to explain this to my kids, it's a total mess. But it's great because I have a big family, and you see it's very genetically diverse. You can see that on this picture. That's me with three of my brothers and sisters. And this gave me, I think, one of the interesting things I think I find every day in my career is the ability to interact with many types of people, very different people, all types of characters, culture, and ways of doing things, and I get this from my childhood. But it tells you also another thing, I think, which is that my schedule when I was a kid was already quite mixed, but not mixed every day, splitted, I should say. And that's important for the rest of the career. You can see here already that I had 2 days at home with my father and 2 days at home with my mother, and 1 weekend was with my father and 1 weekend was with my mother. So I get used to adapt tight schedule, which is also something interesting, I think, but also to know what is important, because when you live in two homes, there are some rules that are the same, and these are the important ones. And of course, the ones that are not the same, you can forget. So my childhood lessons are, being in contact with many people, you adapt to many people and also to the different rules. Of course, you hierarchize the problems and you know what's important and what is not. And of course, which I didn't say yet, is I got very interested in science, and part of it was that for me it was a kind of myself home, I would say, where I was interested in my own questions and I could keep that with me traveling from father to mothers. But my dream job was this. So when I was a kid, I wanted to be Indiana Jones, and I thought it was cool because not just because of archaeology and treasures, but also because you could do geology, you could do optics, you could do biology, and of course you had friends everywhere in the world. So that was really a dream job for me. As you have noticed, it didn't turn out to be like this, but that's a story I'm going to tell you now. As Sulena said, you may think the path is linear, and this is my education path, very classical, but you can already see from the colors that there's a mix of two points, biology and physics. And as Suliana was saying, the changes have occurred at some precise time where I was questioning myself about what I'm going to do. So when I was in bachelor, I was actually an agronomy student. So that's why you have a mix of physics and biology, because it was engineering on one side and it was biology on the other. And so I had a big question at the end of the bachelor. I mean, in France, it's 2, 2, and 1, so the bachelor actually has after 2 years. And there I had to question myself a lot and decide whether I'm gonna go for geology and whether I would go for biology. And at the time, I was deeply interested in physics, and it was very, very clear that in geology, there was a lot of physics. And so I was very interested in going into that. But in biology, it was much less clear what kind of interface could be with chemistry or physics. And why I'm saying this is because I choose the wrong one. I choose biology, which turned out to be the right one, because nowadays, physics in geology is known. It's just part of geology. But physics in biology was not. At the time, it was unknown. And that was a career break, I think, that was very early. I choose definitely to go to biology. And then I did 2 years of cell and molecular biology over my first year, and I really got bored with only biology. I mean, for me, the concepts were very, very basic. Proteins, proteins interaction, protein DNA interaction, and that's it. And that was really, after 2 years, I had enough of this. So I really wanted to go back to physics, and so I did a master's in physics. That was really, really hard, I tell you. It was really, really a big change. But that allowed me then to go for a PhD in between two labs, as you will see in physics and biology. So my lessons from education is to learn different sciences, it's difficult to mix. You have to learn them one after the other. You have to be really drawn in one and then move to the next one and learn the other one. And I would say that you never learn them all. You have one, I'm a biologist, but I can talk many science. So I have the vocabulary and some of the concepts coming from physics that allow me to interact with many of the physicists. And I think this is how you can conceive a career, not just for academics, but also for your any career. You have to have solid knowledge in one thing, and then use this and learn many, many other things to be able to interact with many people. And also what I learned, which I think is something that is not always said loud, we have a tendency to cluster with people that all like us, but the reality is that you always learn more from people that are very far away from you. And I use scientifically term here, but it's also true in everyday's life. The further you are away from someone, the more you're gonna learn from them. And that's very important, and Suleana, I think, had good examples of this in her talk. And that's where I really got convinced that science was cool and that I wanted to stay interdisciplinary. So my path is a bit less linear than Suliana's. So I was raised in Bordeaux in France, and I moved to Lyon for studies, then to Paris, which is very classical for France. And then I went to the US East Coast Yale University for a postdoc, and I came back to Paris where I was a staff scientist at the CNRS for 3 years. And then I was, now since 2010, I'm in Geneva. And what is even more interesting, I think, is that you can see that these different institutions are not all the same in terms of color for physics and biology. And you can see that I've moved from institution, from countries to countries, but also from physics and biology. And I think this is interesting because there is now places where you do the two sciences together, but at the time it was not the case. And I was actually quite separated in terms of institutions. And during my PhD, even though it's two colors, I was physically in two labs. I had one lab in physics, and I had to cross the road to go to the biology department. So it is still quite separated in terms of disciplines. So what we do in every day, in the lab every day, is to do this circle. And I'm not going to comment it more because you have done it. We do observation. We design experiment to eventually try to test our hypothesis coming from observations, and then we do analysis and conclusions. And what I think is interesting is that this part is, so the observation and questioning part is definitely more on the dream. What we do every day in the lab, our experiment, and that's a very artisanal work. And don't misunderstand me, this is a very valuable part. That's where you learn the techniques, and this is something you can value, and you have skills in that, but also in the first part. And the last part is, of course, what you have learned at school, scientific reasoning, and that is to be concrete and real and to make things happen. So what we are doing is really to bridge, to make your dream come true by using the artisanal science. This is a bit biased because actually what we're doing is just the reverse. The reality is telling us which dreams are right and which dreams are wrong. Of course, we have many dreams, but it's not us that decide what is true and what is not. So if you look my career, my dream was this. The reality is that, so I'm not quite there. It's obvious that I still have to work a little bit on my career path like you may have. So I want to give you one example of this constant observation, design, and analysis process. And this is one of my main studies. It's a movie. I don't know if I can cut the sound. Maybe we just watch the movie.
In endocytosis, dynamin dimers associate in a helical collar at the neck of the clathrin-coated pits. Upon GTP hydrolysis, dynamin undergoes a conformational change leading to torsion and constriction of the helix. Fission happens at the edge of the dynamin coat, where membrane stress is the largest. The protein components disassemble to be recycled.
So the whole story started, which I showed you, from a simple observation from a movie like this, where we put GTP on tubules coated with dynamin and they all break. And if we looked in, with more details what was going on, we could observe formation of supercoiling, and in some cases you could see the rotation of dust that was attached to the tube when it was actually breaking. So I had the idea that the fission could occur by torsion, as you have seen on the movie, and that the torsion could be generated by this conformational change associated with GTP. So I designed a very simple experiment where I took a bead and I put it on these dynamin-coated tubes, and by putting GTP, I expected it to rotate. And indeed, that's what we observed. You see here the movie with the tube. There's one bead, and the bead rotates when GTP comes in. Why I'm showing you this is because this is exceptional. You do this once in your career life. It's you have an idea, you see something, you have an idea, and immediately you can design an experiment. This happened to me once, and that was the time, and this is done. Now my career is done. I'm sorry to say it. Okay, this is the science, the reasoning part is redoing the analysis to really prove your point, and I won't go into this detail, but this is exceptional to have such a linear path, okay? But still, it's always the example that people will give you. What I want to insist is that you never do science alone. You have a group of people, and this is only a part of my group. And we do this process all together, and we put all our efforts into doing it together. So for example, if I take one example, Nicola came with an observation, and he had an hypothesis about it. And so he designed an experiment to do it. And then we thought about the results and discuss it and analyze it, and we conclude the things together. On the other side, Katerina had taken an idea that I had in mind, but had no ideas how to do an experiment, and she designed the experiment by herself, and she came up with very, very creative ideas. And of course, she did and performed the experiment, and I was there only really at the end to finalize the process, I would say. And Jorge had an idea, fantastic idea about how escorts are implicated in receptor-mediated recycling. And then we designed together the experiments to do, and we did the analysis together. So really, this process is a group process, and this is true for any work you will have. You work together, not against each other. And this is without telling you that, of course, these are just interactions I had with these people, but they do interact a lot in the lab, and they all benefit to each other. So it's not one plus one, but it's one plus one equals many. So my career lessons, and I'm going to end with this, is what we do in the lab, I think, is still to have a scientific dream and try to turn it into reality, or I should say we test it against reality and see what is true and what is not. And one group of people, many scientific dreams. So you can, when you're a group leader, what you gain in this is that you had your own idea before. Now you can open your mind and see the world as it is, many dreams. And a group of people, means also many achievements. And so it's very, very rewarding to see these dreams becoming true every day in the lab. And I think this is something you have to consider if you are interested in the science academic pathway. And with this, of course, I will thank people. And of course, I'm late.